Good morning everybody, welcome to your 10th online lecture in general surgery. Today we will be discussing the surgical site infections in continuation of your part 1 of these same lectures. So what are the sequelae of uncontrolled infections? Bacteremia, presence of bacteria, living bacteria in the blood or circulation, septicemia, the production of septic chemicals by these bacteria which are causing the bacteremia, and these toxins then circulate in the blood. This is septicemia. Then you have systemic inflammatory response syndrome or SIRS, and this may then be followed by sepsis. Then we have sepsis syndrome, multiple organ dysfunction syndrome or MODS, and in the end we have multiple system organ failure, MSOF. Generally, the severity is increasing as we go down this list. So after bacteremia and septicemia, the next sequelae is systemic inflammatory response syndrome or SIRS. This can be initiated by both infective and non-infective causes like burns, multiple trauma. What it needs to be understood is that this is a systemic inflammatory response, and it doesn't need to have infection as the cause. Multiple trauma and burns can themselves initiate systemic inflammatory response. Do not confuse SIRS SIRS with bacteremia. So following criteria has to be present before you can label any patient as having SIRS. The temperature is either more than 38 degrees centigrade, that is 100.4 degrees Fahrenheit, or it is less than 36 degrees centigrade, 96.48 degrees Fahrenheit. So this is hypothermia, this is hyperthermia. Then pulse can be either more than 90 or less than 60 beats per minute. Respiratory rate has to be more than 20 per minute, and the total leukocyte count is either more than 12,000 or less than 4,000. So the question arises, why the hypothermia, why the bradycardia, why the reduced TLC? When the host is so weak, or the illness has made the host so weak that he is now unable to generate an inflammatory response, then the patient starts developing hypothermia and bradycardia, and this is actually a worse state compared to a hyperthermic, or at least here the body is fighting the systemic inflammatory response. The body has the energy to generate a systemic inflammatory response. Then we come to sepsis. A systemic manifestation of the systemic inflammatory response syndrome with documented infection, for example multiple abscesses, is called sepsis. So this is the next step forward, or a more severe condition where there are infective organisms and abscesses present in the body, and the body also has systemic inflammatory response. Then we come to sepsis syndrome. So sepsis syndrome is sepsis with evidence of one or more organ failures. So here not only is sepsis present, but it is also accompanied by at least one organ system failure. So respiratory failure like acute respiratory distress syndrome or ARDS, cardiovascular failure as in septic shock, renal failure as in acute tubular necrosis, hepatic failure ब्लड कोएगुलोपैथी एज इन डीआईसी डिसेमिनेटेड इंट्रावेस्कुलर कोएगुलेशन एंड सेंट्रल नर्वस सिस्टम साइंस लाइक कोमा एंड डिसोरिएंटेशन दे ऑल कम अंडर सेप्सिस सिंड्रोम. देन यू हैव मल्टीपल ऑर्गन डिसफंक्शन सिंड्रोम MODS. This is dysfunction. This is mediated by the release of cytokines, interleukin 6, tumor necrosis factor alpha, etc. And in its most severe form, it may then progress from dysfunction to multiple system organ failure or MSOF. These are all the cascade of complications and sequelae of surgical site infections. So what are the basics of treatment of a surgical infection? First and foremost, the wound may need opening and debridement. As we discussed earlier, you have to remove all dead tissue, foreign material, any contaminants that may be present in the wound before the wound can start healing. Otherwise, these foreign material and contaminants will continue creating pus in the wound, and the wound will be unable to heal. As we will discuss further, these bacteria produce a lot of chemicals and toxins which counter the body's healing efforts. Then you have to give appropriate antibiotic treatment, and this should ideally be based on the guided by culture and sensitivity tests. So any wound with pus or infection, when you're doing your debridement, you must take the dead and necrotic tissue or the pus in the wound and send it to the lab for culture and sensitivity. Usually you'll get a report within 48 to 72 hours, and that will help you decide in which antibiotics are most suitable for the patient. In the meantime, of course, you will start with broad spectrum antibiotics. Generally, these include a third generation cephalosporin, an aminoglycoside, and an anaerobic antibiotic like metronidazole. Then repeated dressings to remove the pus, to wash the wound, and to keep it generally clean. One point needs to be kept in mind, that antibiotics do not replace surgical drainage. Wherever surgical drainage, debridement, or surgical toilet is required, antibiotics alone cannot do the job. You have to do the mechanical work first, and then the antibiotics may work. Antibiotics are generally only used in spreading infections or where there are systemic signs of infection. Otherwise, in generally clean and healing wounds, you can do away with antibiotics and restrict yourself to only sterile dressings. Antibiotics, whenever they are used in difficult cases, they should be used according to organism sensitivity, as according to the culture and sensitivity report that you get back from the lab. As we know, there are four classes of operative wounds. Clean class 1 wounds are the elective, primarily closed and undrained surgical wounds, surgical incisions, where no viscus has been opened and there is no break in the aseptic technique, and you don't expect an infection rate of more than 4% in such cases. Then there are clean contaminated wounds, class 2. Here the respiratory tract or the GI tract, genitourinary tract, or the biliary tract has been opened under controlled conditions. And as we know, all these tracts have commensal bacteria, and occasionally they can be carriers to resistant organisms. And whenever you open them, even under controlled conditions, the risk of infection increases to 5 to 15% expected rate of infection. The class 3 wounds are the contaminated wounds. These are generally seen in trauma. And here the sterile technique, of course, is broken, or there may be gross spillage from the GI tract. And there is acute non-purulent inflammation already present in these cases, and the anticipated infection rate is 15 to 25%. Then you have dirty infected wounds, class 4, traumatic wounds with retained devitalized tissue, foreign bodies, fecal contamination, especially fecal contamination. Bacteria can be very virulent, and there is acute bacterial inflammation has already set in, and there is pus formation, gross pus formation. Here the infection rate in the wound is 25 to 40%. Generally, before the such wounds are closed, the surgeon will do a thorough lavage either of the peritoneal cavity, and then after closing the peritoneum, of the wound itself, to try and mitigate the contamination of the wound walls and prevent infection. Now we come to certain specific wound infections which are important in clinical practice. First is gas gangrene. Gas gangrene is caused by Clostridium perfringens bacilli. These are anaerobic, gram-positive, spore-bearing bacilli, and there is increased risk of gas gangrene in wounds, especially which are puncture wounds. Puncture wounds, as we know, are the ones where the entry point is small, but the depth of the wound is large, like in sharp stiletto injuries, thorns, or metal nails. If these are contaminated with soil or foreign material or necrotic material, then these may be carrying Clostridium perfringens on them. And once this Clostridium perfringens is deposited in the depths of the wound, the puncture wound may itself close, or the soft tissues in between may oppose with swelling, and thus this creates an anaerobic environment in the depths of the wound where these Clostridia can and then proliferate. Then if the patient is immunocompromised, diabetic, or has a malignancy, again, as we know, if the host defenses are low, then the chances of any bacterial growth are more. So what are the signs of gas gangrene? There is severe local pain, and then there is crepitus on palpation. Crepitus is the bubble bursting type feeling under the skin in the subcutaneous fat when you palpate the area. There's a thin brown sweet smelling exudate from the puncture wound or from the incisions that you might give for debriding the infected area. These bacteria are releasing hyaluronidase, collagenases, proteases, and alpha toxins into the tissues, which cause spread of edema and the gangrene and compromise the blood supply and create an anaerobic environment. And this spreads rapidly in hours. And there are early systemic complications. All the signs that we discussed earlier, hyperthermia, raised TLC, raised pulse, raised respiratory rate, and then multiple system organ failure follows as the toxins in the blood increase to a certain level. So these are cases where surgical intervention is required as an emergency, because even 4 to 6 hours may make, instead of debridement, you may end up having to amputate a limb. And very aggressive and early intervention, surgical intervention is required in addition to giving appropriate treatment and antibiotics. Antibiotic prophylaxis is always recommended in patients who are at risk, and especially when dealing with necrotic ulceration or immunocompromised patients, or where the nature of the wound or the possibility of contamination is such that the soil and grit may have gone into the wound. There the antibiotic prophylaxis should be selected, which also covers Clostridium perfringens. So aggressive debridement of the tissue, limb amputation if required, large doses of benzyl penicillin. In addition to the broad spectrum antibiotics we discussed earlier, benzyl penicillin in heavy doses, 10 lakh units, 20 lakh units may be given every 6 hours to counter the infection. But aggressive debridement of the tissue is a must. Use of hyperbaric oxygen has been shown to be beneficial in some researches, but it is still controversial. Plus, at the same time, it is not readily available generally. Another specific wound infection that is important is tetanus. This is caused by Clostridium tetani. These are anaerobic, spore-bearing, gram-positive bacilli. Their spores are widespread in soil and manure. It is the spores which are problematic in both these infections, in gas gangrene and tetanus, because these make these bacteria very hardy and difficult to eradicate, and they survive for long times in the soil and manure. So signs and symptoms of tetanus are mediated by the release of toxin tetanospasmin. It affects the neuromuscular junction or the myoneural junction, as well as the motor neurons of the anterior horn of the spinal cord. A long prodromal period of 4 to 5 weeks after the injury or after the entry of the bacilli into the wound is associated with a good prognosis, but short prodromal period is associated with bad prognosis, meaning that the dose of contaminants is high, and we need to be careful that occasionally the patient has even forgotten the thorn prick or the small puncture injury that he received 3 to 4 or 5 weeks ago, and that may apparently on the face may have closed with only a mild ache left behind, but in the depths of the wound the bacteria are growing and they are starting to produce the tetanospasmin. And this toxin, when it enters the circulation, it then reaches the neuromuscular junctions and the motor neurons of the anterior horn. And the first sign that you see is the entry wound may show localized cellulitis and exudate, or as I said earlier, it may appear on the surface as if it is healing. There is spasm in the distribution of the motor neurons of the face in the early phase. The earliest signs are trismus or lockjaw, and then this may be followed by generalized motor spasms of the body, fits, tetanus-induced fits in the patient, which may include opisthotonus, and risus sardonicus. Risus sardonicus is the spasm of the facial muscles, which pulls the angles of the mouth downwards and backwards, and creating a sardonic smile, spastic smile on the face. Opisthotonus is the extreme extension of the erector spinae muscles. extensor spiny muscles, and the patient is during the fits is like a reverse C. The spasm of the respiratory muscles may lead to respiratory arrest, and the patient may die because of asphyxia. Prophylaxis of tetanus is important. Prophylaxis is done with thorough wound cleaning and debridement, and then tetanus toxide or TT is a formalin attenuated vaccine. TT vaccine is given initially 3 doses. Here we are talking about simple prophylaxis, not after the infection has taken place. The average young adult, initially yearly basis, on an yearly basis you have to give 3 doses every year, 1 dose, 0.5 ml of the tetanus toxoide intramuscular for the first 3 years, and then a 5 yearly booster is required for active immunization. Active immunization generally takes 4 to 6 weeks to develop. So 0.5 ml TT to be given IM if last booster was given more than 5 years ago. So whenever you get a patient roadside accident, or a child has fallen off a bicycle and there appears to be a puncture wound, generally you don't expect tetanus to develop in a superficial wide abrasion, because these are anaerobic organisms and they generally do not grow in an aerobic environment. But where there is a deep puncture wound, then you inquire whether the child or the adult had received any immunization or a booster dose within the past 5 years, and if the patient has received tetanus toxoide injection more than 5 years ago, then you must give a booster dose of 0.5 ml tetanus toxoide. Then there is passive immunization with human anti-tetanus globulin. This is given if the immunization status of the patient is unknown, because if you give a tetanus toxoide now, then it will take 4 to 6 weeks for the immunity to develop. And in this period, if tetanus develops, then the patient will become critical. So 250 to 500 milligrams of tetanus toxoide is given intramuscularly. It may be half of it may be given around the wound, and half in the opposite side of the body intramuscularly. So in summary, tetanus toxoid booster, if it has been received within 5 years of the current wound, then no further immunization is required. However, if the tetanus toxoid booster was received prior to 5 years of the injury, then give a booster dose of 0.5 ml tetanus toxoide intramuscularly. And if the immunization status is unknown, that give human anti-tetanus globulin 250-500 milligram intramuscular stat for immediate passive immunization, and begin active immunization with 0.5 ml TT given at IM given at month 0, month 1 and month 2. That means 3 doses given on a monthly basis every 30 days. So in 2 months you will have given 3 doses at 0, 1 and 2 months. And in the meantime, the passive immunity that you have given with human anti-tetanus globulin, that will cover the patient. So the treatment of tetanus, once you start noticing any exudate or infection at the wound site, wide surgical debridement is most essential, because that is the only way you can remove the colonies of the bacilli and the tetanospasmin that they are producing. Antibiotic treatment with benzyl penicillin and metronidazole is a must. and these are anaerobes, so metronidazole and benzyl penicillin is specific for the Clostridia. Human anti-tetanus globulin to limit the effects of free toxins which have already been released into the circulation. The tetanospasmin that is already now circulating, you have to give passive immunization. Then once the lockjaw or the rhizus or opisthotonic fits have started, then the patient needs to be sedated with the IV diazepam repeated doses, and in severe cases you have to give muscle relaxants, and if the oxygen saturation or respiratory effort has been compromised, then you have to paralyze the patient and put the patient on ventilator, because these convulsions, during the period of the convulsion, the respiratory muscles are also in spasm and the patient cannot breathe. So you have to put the patient on ventilator and paralyze the muscles so that the neuromuscular junctions can relax and the ventilator can do the job of breathing for the patient. Tracheostomy and ventilation is therefore required in such severe cases where you are expecting the patient to remain on ventilator for some time. Tracheostomy is better than just endotracheal intubation. So with that, we come to the end of the specific surgical site infections. Thank you very much. See you next time with your next lecture.